Welcome to the Association for Heterodox Economics webinars. This is our 22nd annual conference that we this year have chosen to hold online due to everybody knows. We have had different webinars Thursday of and Friday all over July, and this is our last and final week, week number 5 and our 8th session. And this session is focusing on racism, sexism, and development. We have 3 great speakers, and we're really excited to see all 3 presentations. We are going to have them in the order that we're starting with Christina Rice from Federal University of ABC in Brazil. She's presenting the economic development of Latin America and its main problems in a feminist perspective. Our second speaker is Surbhi Kesar from Asim Premji University in India, and she's presenting economic dualism, precarity and exclusion, employment transitions and economic transformations in India. Our final speaker is Peter Doyle, who is an independent scholar. So how this session is going to work is, we're going to have 20 minutes per speaker. You guys can post questions in the Q&A button in the bottom of your Zoom screen. And then we will take these questions and post them to our panelists in the end of this session. If you have any technical problems and you want to let me or my co-chair, Yuridis, know, please use the chat to post these questions. So the Q&A for questions for the panelists and the chat for any technical problems that you want to let me or my co-chair know. I would also like to say to people that you can become a member of the AHE, of this association, or donate any money on our website, which is on heticon.net membership. We are running these sessions without any cost. We're keeping them free. We want to be able to reach as many people as possible. But if you have any possibilities to either donate or want to become a member, please do so. I think this is a good time to start our presentations. And if we start with you, Christina.
Yeah, let's go. So I'll share my screen now. Okay, can you see it? Can you see my presentation? Yes, and do you hear me well?
Yeah, we hear you well, thank you.
Okay, so good afternoon to you. Here it's still good morning in Brazil. Before introducing myself and the paper, I would like to say that I regret that we are not meeting in person at the UK, and that we are experiencing this very sad, serious humanitarian crisis and global crisis, and which here in Brazil is really, really bad now. And so it's a very sad moment in history. But still, we have the chance to be connected and be reflecting on all this and all the regular issues that we think about in our academic lives, but especially trying to bring this to this actual reality, the current reality, which makes everything more difficult, I think. So there are many windows opening to us to change the history now and fighting for a more equal and fair world. And so there are many challenges, but it's really, for me, it's really a paradox to be here talking about feminism while there are so many people suffering outside. I mean, we don't have to stop thinking and talking and making our and working, but it's really difficult to handle and to deal with all this, right? So thank you for being part of this section. And well, our paper is actually very bold. We are making a parody. I don't know if this is the way that I should say this word, parody, of Raul Prebisch's manifesto, which was published 71 years ago. The background of this paper, I will share with you. So I am an economist, and Fernanda is also an economist, and Regimeire, she's a political scientist. And we all work at the Federal University of ABC, which has this weird name because ABC are the acronym, is the acronym for the industrial area of São Paulo, which is located in four cities close to São Paulo City in Brazil, which are Santo André, São Bernardo, and São Caetano. So that's why ABC, the first letters of the names of the saints, who names the cities where the industries in Brazil were. So let's say around in the past, almost all the manufacturing production in Brazil was produced in the ABC area. Now I think it's only 40 or 50%. But the university is really new, and it was a really old demand from the laborers of these industries, and it was actually one of the demands of the former president Lula, Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva, who came from São Bernardo do Campo. So he was in the union there, the trade union there. And one of the agenda or the demands the people were calling, the laborers were calling for a federal university in the region, which came only when Lula was president. So it's a very new university, and the university is interdisciplinary. And it was at this university that I started to think about feminism and racism. More academically, let's say. And it was thanks to Regimeire that we could bring the feminist fight to this paper. Why? Let me tell you why. I and Fernanda, we've been studying the economic development from the structural point of view since ever. And we noticed that this stream of thought is really economicist and Eurocentric. And although it's very important, and it's one stream of thought that is really challenging the mainstream, it's a heterodox, it was always made by men, actually by white men. There were some exceptions, but most of the people writing were white men. And that explains why some crucial problems of the Latin America was never mentioned, like racism and sexism and machismo and misogynist. So these kind of problems were not in their minds. And this was astonished me so much because we cannot say that 70 years ago there was not a problem of racism and feminism. There were so many problems, but they were not even considered in the what being so-called Latin American manifesto about development. So actually this paper is a provocation. We rewrote the paper, the first part of the paper, saying that the main problems are actually the inequalities between ethnical ratio and gender inequalities. These are crucial problems and we have to talk about it. So this is the story behind the paper. Raul Prebisch was an economist. and his manifest is considered the milestone for the Latin American economic thinking. And he made the diagnosis of Latin America problems, but the diagnoses were really economic and they were centered in the what later was called the deterioration of the terms of trade of primary goods vis-a-vis manufactured goods. Okay, so it, which means that during the time, according to this concept, the prices of the commodity exports were getting lower, and the prices of the manufacturers exports were getting higher in relation to one another, and then this would bring a huge balance of payments constraint for the commodity exporters. So one of the things that that really divides the structuralist thought from the others is to take the world system as a centri-periphery world system. This idea actually was not new, was brought from the imperialist literature, but it was a new way of selling the idea, and it was more conservative, let's say, because Raul Prebisch, he was not at all a communist. He was actually anti-communist, and he was a rich man that was working in the private sector, and he was actually the president of the central bank in Argentina. So he was not defeating the interests of poor people in Latin America. He was actually trying to build a national developmentalist plan for Argentina and for the Latin America region. So his manifesto was really important. And he placed industrialization as the main solution for Latin America problems, and it became one of the most dear concepts for the CEPALIN, the ECLAC, and the Economic Commission Latin America developmental theory. So the objective of our paper, as I was saying, is to re-signify the manifesto, but from a feminist perspective. It is actually an intertext. So if you read this, I recommend you to read together with the original manifesto, because it contains ironies. Actually, I was having a lot of fun while I was writing the manifesto, our manifesto, because I was literally changing some words from the original manifesto and trying to show how ridiculous some of the statements are. I don't think that if Fernanda was presenting, she would say something like I'm saying, but I don't like the manifesto so much, because for me, it's really astonishing that some people's problems, the poor people problems, were not even considered in the manifesto. And we brought feminism because we wanted to show how the feminist struggles can be the basis for the renewed epistemology that interprets development. So in this picture, you see Lélia Gonzalez. She was a great Brazilian thinker. She was poor. Her mother was a maid, and her father was working in the railways in Minas Gerais, which is another state from Brazil. And then she went to Rio de Janeiro. She was born in 1935. She went to Rio de Janeiro when she was 10. And then she graduated. She took a philosophy bachelor. And then later she started teaching at public schools and private schools as well in the basic and secondary education, and then later she became a university teacher as well. And she brings a lot of many contributions to the feminist intellectual production in Brazil, but mainly to the feminist fight political action in Brazil. And this is something that really differentiates feminism in Latin America, from feminism from maybe from other regions, because it was initially a political action and then it was brought to the academic field. So the academic feminism as a theoretical and ethical position is an extension of this political agenda in the philosophy, in the analysis of discourse, in the social sciences, and also in the economy. Well, so the manifesto's structure is more or less a parody of the original manifesto, which has two parts. Section one is the introduction, and then sections 2 to 6, Prebisci was dealing with concepts like technical progress, productivity, external constraints, capital formation, inflation, and industrialization. Our manifesto in the first part intertextualizes the sections 1 to 5 from the original manifesto, and then the second part will make a historical reconstruction of the feminist fight and the development of feminism in Latin America. So, regarding the first part of the manifesto, there are some points that I would like to highlight, but I just will read one passage to show you. I don't know if you had the chance to read the Prebisci's manifesto ever in your life, but it just, if you had, you will notice why I say that it contains ironies, okay? So we started like this. Reality has been destroying Latin America. The international division of labor, as well as its domestic divisions, despite historical modernization, continues to lead to abyssal inequalities of gender, race, and class. Latin America is still seen as a source of food and raw materials, isolated not only by geography from the dynamic centers of the international division of labor, and then parentheses, which people now are calling global value chains, and this is actually my main topic of research, currently referred as global value chain, even after having been urbanized and industrialized with marked regional and local differences. The facts impose themselves. The path of industrial activity was not deep enough for, and never intended to, make structural and institutional changes that would substantiate gender, race, and class equality. So, as I was saying, industrialization was the main mechanism, according to Prebisci and other structuralists, to change the reality in Latin America. And nowadays, and many other authors have criticized this idea, because we know that not simply industrializing matters, but the way you industrialize, how industrialize, and what's the country's productive and trade specialization, and what's the insertion into this international division of labor, right? So, but the way that industrialization was made in Latin America was actually a conservative modernization of the former institutional and structural features in the historical path. So the development of Latin America and its problems should be analyzed from a new point of view that breaks with this economicism, because it's really focusing only on economic aspects, and which breaks with Eurocentrism, because it's really clear when you read the original manifesto and many other works that come later, that they are taking Europe as the main reference for development. And so we should let Latin America develop the mechanism that made Europe develop. And so we know that this etapist way of thinking was already very criticized and it doesn't work. And so there are many new epistemologies that we discuss. What's the concept actually of development? What do we mean by development? Development for whom, made by whom, and what do we want to reach? Because it's not necessarily material accumulation, and even if it is, what does it mean in terms of using the resources we have of sustainability and of course of fighting gender and race inequalities. As a Brazilian talk a lot, sorry. So the second part of the manifesto will bring the feminist fighting and struggles in Latin America to show that there are many interesting insights and contributions that should be taken to build a new epistemology to understand development. And this is really important because when talking about development, some categories are taken as favorite, like the category of class. So I still hear my colleagues here in Brazil, brilliant economists, saying that the race and the gender agenda are embedded in the class agenda, that we have actually a problem of class struggles between laborers and capitalists. And we want to change this perspective, and not really to show which one is better, but to show that all of them are important to make a new epistemology. An analysis focused on class relations can leave out gender relations and racism shaped. An analysis focused on class relations can leave out how gender relations and racism shape domination in capitalism, reduces therefore its capacity to explain current forms of domination and patterns of inequality. So the main message of the second part is that that feminists face an even greater burden than those that conventionally attributed to them as women. Because even within the progressive universe in which they organize themselves, they ideologically disputed interpretations of shared reality. So the contribution of feminism is very strong because it was born in the political agenda, the political fight. And we are not fighting only for women, we are fighting for reducing and eliminating all kinds of domination. So the message of this part is like, so what society does the women's struggle aim for? So of course there is not only one answer, but in the case of Latin America, this question certainly comes up against the development path that the region has experienced. It's possible to think not only of a narrative from within about the problems that structurally affect the region, but also to present alternatives for the construction of a feminist dialogue. So therefore, I think that feminism can be a new starting point for a new epistemology for thinking on development, not only in Latin America, but elsewhere. That's it. I hope I didn't explode my 20 minutes.
Oh, brilliant. No, I think you're my first speaker that kept within time. Thank you so much. That is a great presentation. Very, very interesting. We are going to jump straight into a second presentation, reminding people if they have questions, please use the Q&A button, or please ask questions, make comments using the Q&A button in the bottom of the Zoom window. Going straight into a second presenter, Serbi Kesar. Please start your presentation. So you are still on mute. Oh, perfect.
Yeah. Thanks, Alexandra. So today I'm presenting on economic dualism, precarity and exclusion, employment transitions, and economic transformation in India. So what I'm going to be arguing today is something that is a work in progress, and I would really like your comments on it. So let's kind of go back into in terms of the standard development theory and what it signifies for what is it that I'm arguing today. So in much of the literature on economic development, there's a characteristic distinction that's identified between the developed versus a less developed economy, or what I'll refer to as LDE from here on. The LDE is characterized by an economic dualism between, let's say, its traditional non-capitalist segment and a modern capitalist segment. On the other hand, a developed economy is considered to be homogeneously modern. Now, following this, the process of economic development is expected to entail interrelated processes of structural change, such that there is a transformation of this dualist structure with economic growth along the lines of the advanced capitalist economy. So the underlying idea being that this dualism between the non-capitalist and capitalist segment, which characterize the developing or the less developed economy, is expected to dissolve with higher economic growth, and sort of the entire structure modernizes into an overall capitalist structure, which is which characterizes the developed economy. However, in India, what happened, and also in several other LDEs, with high economic growth, while there was a shift away from agriculture, what came into being was these non-capitalist spaces, even within these industrial and urban areas, which were earlier understood to be locations mainly of the capitalist enterprises. So this is what T.G. McGee characterizes in a classic article, Peasant in the Cities. So you're in the cities, you're moving towards that sort of a transition that you're talking about, mainly in terms of urbanization and industrialization, but your non-capitalist segments, which were earlier only in the rural traditional agriculture areas, are now being reproduced even within these modern and within these urban and manufacturing segments. So this is what has been the characterization for a lot of LDEs, and this is kind of what can be seen as a roadblock to the entire capitalist development process, because the idea was that with economic growth, these non-capitalist segments would wither away, but rather what we see is a mushrooming of these non-capitalist segments even within the industrial and urban areas. Now, this it mainly manifested itself in terms of informal sector enterprises. Now, generally, informality also extends beyond just the enterprises that we're talking about and manifests itself in terms of two forms. One, in terms of, let's say, the enterprises, the non-capitalist enterprises, which can be seen where production structures are distinct from that in the capitalist enterprises. And these enterprises are mainly characterized by petty commodity production, where there's no hired worker, and it's mainly run by household members. Now, given this absence of a capital wage labor relation, we can characterize them as the non-capitalist segment. And they're mainly geared towards satisfying the subsistence need of the household, which kind of operates it, which is involved in the operation of this these enterprises. And another part of this informality, which kind of is seen as this roadblock of the development process, is basically the people who were in fact proletarianized, that is, they were not in this non-capitalist segment and were included in the capitalist space, but they're characterized by even worse remuneration than what one would receive in the non-capitalist segment. So these are the casual, informal wage employment characterized by very precarious working conditions. Now, in the literature, it's generally there are various views in terms of how to understand this persistence of informality. Some of the classic dualist views would actually argue that the formal and the informal are two very distinct segments with distinct structural logics, whereas the other tradition, which is mainly from World Bank and De Soto and legalist view and stuff, which argue that, look, they're not two distinct structural logics that operate in these two segments of the economy, but what is rather happening is that these are just some smaller firms which are facing different constraints. Otherwise, they operate with a similar economic logic. Now, even within the dominant heterodox traditions, the idea is that there is one logic of capital which governs or subjugates all the segments. That is, the non-capitalist segment would persist mainly in order to satisfy the needs of the capitalist segment. However, one of the unifying thread among all these traditions have been that that there would in fact be an economic transformation via, there would actually be a transformation via growth. So that has kind of been a unifying thread. However, there are some interesting departures from relatively less dominant heterodox perspectives in this idea of development. For example, the works by Quijano and Nun in Latin America around the 70s, where they're arguing that what you see as a non-capitalist segment is not a remnant of the past that is not withering away, but rather it is basically reproduced due to an offshoot of the growth process. And this non-capitalist segment is not needed by the capitalist segment for its existence. Rather, it's surplus to the entire process of capitalist development. Interestingly, another strand, a very important strand that's come from India and characterizing mainly the Indian development trajectory, has been by Kalyan Sanyal, where he argues that the post-colonial capitalist development has a very characteristic feature, that being that with this process of economic growth, or rather capitalist development, the founding block has been the primitive accumulation, which is continuously happening. So what really happens is that resources are extracted from the traditional and non-capitalist segment and are transferred to the capitalist segment. However, the labor or the workers or the population that subsists in this non-capitalist segment is not really absorbed in the capitalist segment. Now, this population that is excluded from its resources and is not included within the capitalist segment is then forced to reproduce its conditions of livelihood by recreating this non-capitalist segment. So that is how the process takes place. So therefore, via this growth process, what's kind of happening is that this process, this non-capitalist segment, which was expected to wither away with growth, is constantly reproduced. Now, what we are going to do here is basically, while there is an understanding of broadly how the structure is expected to evolve, but much of this literature kind of misses out on what is the underlying process of the transition through which the structure of dualism evolves. And that is one thing that we're kind of trying to explore. Now, in order to explore that, we also depart from the strict binaries of formal informal, which is how much of the development discourse right now understand the condition, the issues of development, but rather focus on distinction, particularly the fundamental distinction is in terms of capitalist and non-capitalist spaces to characterize the economic dualism. And that has to be our locus of understanding if we want to understand the process of capitalist development, because that's pretty much the transition of the non-capitalist space to the capitalist space. So that's going to be our locus, and that's where we're going to situate the analysis of dualism per se. Second point that we want to keep in mind is that while non-capitalist and capitalist space can be two blocks or two segments that exist, but there's a lot of heterogeneity even within it, which, as we will show later, is important to be recognized to understand the process of development. Why do I say so? For example, even within the capitalist segment, there can be formal secure employment relations that exist. So capitalist segment being there, being a proletarianization of workers and wage workers being there. So there can be in one, there can be these formal capitalists and secure relations that exist. Whereas on the other hand, there can also be these informal wage relations that exist even within the capitalist segment. So we are kind of trying to, understand all of these different heterogeneities, because that will become important in the way we're going to rethink this entire idea of dualism itself. Another part that then we're going to do is basically we're going to develop on Sanyal and kind of extend its understanding to complicate the understanding of dualism by, again, like I said earlier, analyzing the processes through which the non-capitalist segment is reproduced and through which the dualism stays intact. Now, this is a work in progress, so I'm going to here basically try to build on this argument using two illustrations. And of course, I'll be building on that a little further as I go along with this project. So the first thing that I do is basically characterize the economic structure as comprising of different production and labor processes. And now that is non-capitalist and capitalist. And within that, identifying different degrees of informality. And then analyzing the transitions in the Indian economy across these different segments over the past two decades, over periods of the past two decades. Now, the first illustration, what I'm going to do here is, so there's a centrality of growth in the entire process, because the idea is that with economic growth is such a transition expected to happen. So what we are going to do here is, so Indian growth process can roughly now be mapped as a something that has persisted for nearly three decades, but which particularly peaked from around 2003-2014. After 14, it kind of began to falter. Now, we're going to talk about the peak of growth period of 2005 and 11-12, and how have the transitions across these different sectors over this period impacted the structure of dualism. The second illustration that I'm going to talk about here is basically how have these dynamics kind of changed once the growth faltered post-2014? Is there something more central to the growth in terms of how we're analyzing the structure of dualism itself? Now, again, there are going to be a lot of sectors, but I want you to kind of ignore what is basically I'm characterizing each of those. I'll just tell what is my broad idea, and we'll move towards the illustration just in a while. So basically, I'm categorizing households into different sectors based on their primary income sources. Now, these sectors into which they're classified will basically, they are, let's say, within non-agriculture and agriculture, that's a broad distinction. Now, within that, I'm looking at in the non-capitalist spaces and within capitalist space in terms of whether they are bigger employers, big capitalist enterprises, or they are, either they are capitalist enterprises or they are wage relations that exist in terms of casual and informal wage employment or more secure sort of employment relations. So those are the broad sectors that I'm going to be working with, but I'll keep kind of reiterating it so that the thread is not lost. What again, I'm going to talk about here. So all of these NASE, NAE, so these are basically these different sectors. So for example, we're just going to talk about for illustration purpose, so I'll just work with one. So NASE is my non-agricultural self-employed. This is a non-capitalist space that we're talking about in terms of self-employment. Now, the point that I want to make here is that over this period, there's not been much change in the structure, because the lighter bar is telling me what is the proportion that is depending on this sector in period in the first period, that is in 2005, and the darker bar is telling me what is the proportion that depends on it in 2011-12. And what we see is that broadly, there's not been much change. The structures kind of remain, I mean, the proportion depending on each of these sectors has remained pretty much same for all sectors. Now, these different sectors are there on the horizontal axis. But the moment I try to look at what is the proportion that actually transitioned away from each of these sectors over this period, this is what I get. So let me look at again the first period. So the lighter bar is, the first two bars, which is for, again, this non-agricultural self-employment or the non-capitalist segment. And here I'm seeing that 68% of households that depended on this non-capitalist space in period one transitioned towards another period. But what is simultaneously happening is another 65% that were depending on some other segment now transitioned back to it to reconstitute it. So what's really happening is this huge amount of transitions, such that there are households, or rather I'll show later even in terms of individuals, moving away from one employment type or one sort of sector to another sector, and then another huge proportion moving back in. And that's something that's happening across the board for every sector. Another sort of detail that I kind of get into a little is basically explore for each of the sector, where all did they go to and where all did they come from. So I won't get into the details of it, but the broad point that I want to make here is that if, let's say, there's an X percentage of households moving from one sector, from depending on one sector, let's say non-capitalist segment, to, let's say, casual or informal wage labor, which is the second sector that I have here, the two bars, 18.5 and 15.6%. Here, what I'm saying is that 18.5% of households of, let's say, in the non-capitalist segment, that transition towards this casual wage employment, a similar proportion from that segment towards which it had transitioned back. So that's the kind of churn that we are characterizing. Now, why is that important? I'll come to that in a moment. So what's kind of happening is the idea is that this traditional or the non-capitalist segment, the idea is that there's a lack of dynamism in the economy, which is why there's not been a transition that we are seeing, or the capitalist transition that we are seeing. But what instead we find is that there is a continuous recreation of the non-capitalist informal spaces, which is what we are seeing for the Indian economy. And there's a significant role even played by this informal wage employment, which is within the capitalist segment. Again, why it becomes important, I'll come to that in a moment. So this is not a stagnant dualist structure where the non-capitalist and capitalist segment dualism is continuing to persist. Rather, there's this huge dynamism via which this is happening. Now, one thing that could be argued is that a salient feature of the growth period itself. But so much dynamism and churn that's happening, we also analyze the period post 2014, which is post the economic slowdown. Now here, what I have is basically in terms of, this is a different data set, given these are the only panels available for the Indian economy, and I'm using all of them. So the post 2014, I now have data for every, at an annual and even at a quarterly basis. And I'm just going to give one illustration here. Let's say I'm talking about transitions from 2008. Okay.
5 minutes.
From 2018 to 2019. That's the transition that I'm going to be talking about. So here, what I see, if you could just look at the second column, which says transition, again, I see something very similar happening. There's a huge proportion that's transitioning out of that sector. And this is something that is not really seen just for one period. You see it at quarters, you see it every annual period. That's the bulk of a house. This is individual level, and this is talking about their activity type, which are transitioning out of this employment type. So this churn is what I'm kind of trying to characterize. I'll skip this, but it's basically saying that those who did not transition in between 2017-18, 26% of them now transitioned in 2018-19, whereas those that did transition, 52% of them transitioned again. So if you are in particular employment types which are associated with more precarity and vulnerability, you're again more likely to have to look for more other sources of employment. So I'm going to like kind of rush through a few things now and try to build on that argument since I'm running out of time. So on one hand, there is this support that we're finding for Sanyal's sort of an argument, where we're saying that this non-capitalist segment, that it acts as a huge sink or for this surplus population, which is excluded from the capitalist growth process. So these are these victims of primitive accumulation whose resources are taken away, but they're not really proletarianized and included within the capitalist circuit of production as wage workers. Now, this excluded mass of the population has the freedom, quote unquote, freedom to reproduce their conditions of livelihood in the informal economy. So it's this process of capitalist growth that itself recreates the non-capitalist economic spaces. But one question that comes is that then is this population always excluded? Is there a lack of mobility that's happening in the economy? What we see is something more interesting that's happening, which is where our argument comes in, that there are two simultaneous processes. One, there's a process of exclusion that's happening from interior of the capital that regenerates these non-capitalist spaces, which is what we argued following from Sanyal. But what we also see is that even the non-capitalist space, it's not a fixed space. These people are constantly being proletarianized, as we saw in terms of people moving away from the non-capitalist space to wage employment, but particularly the informal wage employment. So they're incorporated in the capitalist spaces as informal or casual wage labor, but then again, in another period, they're dragged back into this non-capitalist space. So while this dualism stays intact, there's this huge sort of churn happening where people are not tied to a particular location and are constantly moving across, thereby reproducing this entire structure. So it's basically, and it's also not limited just to the growth period. It is something that spans across the high growth and the low growth period in India. Now, I'll just take 1 minute to kind of go over something that I wished I had more time to talk about, but I guess I can skip over that, but which is basically saying that within all of this flux, within all of this random movement that's happening, there is also some patterns that can be identified. Now, whether you move from the non-capitalist space to a wage-labor relation, which is more secure, or you move towards one where it's more precarious and informal in nature, depends on a lot of factors, and some of which are structural in nature, such as your caste and ethnicity and religion. And that is what within this flux is are those patterns that we are trying to identify. For example, in India, there are these social hierarchies in terms of caste, and what we see is those belonging to relatively socially backward, quote unquote, caste are less likely to basically transition to a more secure form of wage and employment relation. Whereas those that are, socially forward caste are more likely to be transitioning towards, let's say, more secure forms of wage labor relations from these non-capitalist spaces. And again, this is something that I see across periods, and I'm going to not go into it. I have certain slides on how this process is affected in terms of the pandemic. I can come back to it if there are questions. I'll conclude. Can I take a couple of minutes, Alexandra?
A couple of minutes, yeah.
Yeah, all right. So yeah, I'll just conclude then. So how is it that we are trying to rethink the entire idea of dualism? So there's a substantial volume of transitions that's happening, but the overall structure of dualism continues to be reproduced and stay intact. So it's not the old form of dualism, but a continuous process of reproduction via this embedded dualism. And there is a specific nature to this reproduction, which is this constant reshuffling that's happening across various sectors. Now, we further complicate this capitalist non-capitalist dualism that we characterized in the earlier slides by saying that what seems to be happening is that there is one relatively stable core of the economy and an unstable periphery. So this relatively stable core is like the formal capitalist segment, mainly characterized by, secure wage labor relations, which is something that we see that the regular salaried employer, the permanent salaried employees are least likely to basically be caught in this flux sort of a thing. And there's an unstable periphery, which is heterogeneous and dual, comprising of these micro-capitalist enterprises, non-capitalist enterprises, and wage employment relations, which are informal or insecure in nature. So, and this occupants of the periphery remain in this constant state of flux. To use Bremen's term, it's basically footloose labor without any firm grounding. A proportion of the population transitions along the lines of the standard Lewisian transition that we talked about, but a vast majority fails to do so. And it does so in two forms, either by economically reproducing themselves actively by recreating these non-capitalist spaces, or by traversing an aberrant path of the Lewisian transformation, where they mainly, even if they move towards the capitalist segment, they remain informally employed with really low remuneration. Now, the type of transition, whether you make an expected or aberrant, basically depends on your social identities and is associated with your social identities. So to finalize, as a final point that I want to make, so here the dualism then again kind of relates back to what Sanyal would refer to as moving away from the non-capitalist cap, while having that distinction in place, also characterizing it in terms of, that's a question that I kind of raising in terms of, accumulation-driven economy versus that which is mainly for satisfying the subsistence need of the people. So this, through this, we're providing a fresh, trying to provide a fresh perspective on the process of reproduction of economic dualism with capitalist development, which raises question on the teleological idea of capitalist transition that underlies much of the development discourse. Thank you.
Wow, thank you so much. That is a great presentation. Very, very interesting. I have questions. I've seen other people have questions. So really looking forward to discuss this further. But before we do that, finally, Peter Doyle, independent researcher, are you happy to have the third presentation of the session?
Okay, great. And you can hear me, yes?
We can hear you. Thank you.
Okay, so my first remark is I want to say that is officially an absolutely fascinating presentation on churning. I am officially intrigued by that
Thank
presentation.
You.
And I'm going
Thank
to talk
you.
About a phenomenon which involves virtually no churning at all, which is slavery. And so my paper on this subject covers a great deal of ground. While I could offer a kind of Cliff Notes version of it in these minutes, I thought I would try and do something a bit more ambitious and actually try and add some value to the paper itself. Because if you actually want just a Cliff Notes version of it, you can go and see the blog that I've written on the National Institute website, or you know, skim read the paper, whichever your preference is. But what I want to do in these few minutes is something a bit unusual. Normally in economics, and indeed we've just seen in this very fascinating presentation we just heard, what economics does is come to a phenomenon and try and shed some light, the light of economics on that phenomenon. What I'm going to do in my little talk today is the opposite. I'm going to ask, what light does slavery shed on economics? And in particular, what does slavery imply about the character of economics? And when I say character, I'm using that word in the sense of, you know, back in the day, you know, one used to think of US presidential elections as sure they involve politics and policy and all of that, but they also come down to a question of the character of the candidates. Remember, we used to think that? Well, I'm going to be asking the question, what does slavery imply about the character of economics in that sense of the word character? If you like, you can think of my few comments here as a parallel to that piece which Claudia Sam put out a day or two ago, where she co-wrote Economics as a Disgrace. And she was writing about the behavior of individual economists, which indeed is disgraceful and involves, you know, the whole jerk phenomenon that she was writing about. I'm not going to comment on that. I'm commenting about the character of our corpus of knowledge. I'm going to write about the character of our corpus of techniques that we use and what slavery implies about that. It's very much in parallel to her piece. To get that started, to some basic empirics need to get, I'm going to make 4 points on this and that's all. You need to get some basic orders of magnitude into your head about the phenomenon of slavery as it was practiced in the transatlantic trade. So, if you were to take an African and sell him in the 13 colonies, or as they became the United States prior to 1860, you could, with the proceeds of that sale, buy a house. So the standard kind of house which a white middle-class person would own at the time of his sale. Those were the standard terms of trade. Now, the best numbers are that the total number of Africans transported across the Atlantic by this trade was 12 million. So that's 12 million houses that you have transported across the Atlantic in this business. Well, 12 million is roughly half the number of houses in the United Kingdom today. And it's considerably more, probably, than the number of houses in the United Kingdom at the time that the slave trade was actually going on. In other words, that's starting to give you a sense that this is really an absolutely very big economic business. And that's not all, because in addition to the people who were transported across the across the Atlantic by this trade, you also have people who were born in the New World. And to get a sense of that order of magnitude, again, look at the US numbers. In total, only something like 400,000 people were transported across the Atlantic and taken into the what's now the United States. But by the time 1860 came along, there were 4 million people enslaved. That's up by a factor of 10. 400,000 imported, 4 million emancipated. Well, now you take this total of 12 million across the entire Atlantic, subtract off the 400,000 that went to the United States, that's 11.5. Now increase that by a factor of 10. And now you have a sense of the order of magnitude of this phenomenon relative to the size of the global economy. It was gigantic. And the basic business model involved was to deprive Africans of their economic agency. You took them, you seized them, and you determined what it was that they were going to do. They were going to live on the other side of the world, and they were going to go and pick cotton or crop sugar or whatever it was that they were going to do. So the business model was to deprive them of their economic agency. Now think what it says about the character of economics, that our core notion is an economic agent. Almost all of our papers talk about economic agents running around maximizing this or that subject to budget constraints. It takes no account of the fact that there was this gigantic business operating for three centuries, which was to deprive people of their economic agency. That was the economic content of what was going on. Think what it says about the character of economics, that in our core microeconomic theory, we say nothing about it. It's quite a remarkable feat of intellectual failure, if you ask me. And not just that. If you look at the tiny little corner of our profession, which does actually look at slavery, so there's questions of economic history and ask, what questions do they ask? They ask questions like, could we have industrialized without slavery? Did slavery actually contribute to global output? That's the sort of questions that we ask. Well, think about how ridiculous those questions are. I mean, the way to appreciate how absurd that is consider any list of African-American luminaries you care to think of. So I don't know, starting with the boxers, Jack Johnson, through the Brown Bomber, through Muhammad Ali, through Mike Tyson, and then through others. Think about Michael Jackson or Michael Jordan, or think about Oprah, or think about any of these people, Ben Carson, before he put down his scalpel, and ask yourself, well, would the world have been better off if we stopped them doing what they were doing and sent them out to pick cotton? The answer is so obvious. It is incredible that even our little corner of economics writes books to ask, you know, would output have been higher or lower with slavery? Think about what that says about the character of our discipline. It's not flattering at all. The second point I want to address is not just about kind of the empirics and the fact that we ignore completely this gigantic phenomenon which is occurring at our core. I'm going to make a few points now about the second issue, which is about economics, the language of economics, the language that we use. As we know, the profession has over a period of time become very mathematical. So I'm not addressing that question today. Actually, I have no particular problem with the fact that it's become mathematical. I think it's quite useful for rigor and consistency and all those things. And I think it's been productive. So I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about our use of English, of words, or if not English, maybe Spanish or Portuguese, whatever language, or Indian or Hindu that we're actually writing our economics in. The language that we have adopted as our norm in economics has become completely sanitized. Kind of the sap has been completely taken out of word, including the fact that we refer to everyone as economic agents as opposed to human beings, even a word like that. And the reason why this comes up in the context of the discussion of slavery is when I circulated my paper amongst some of our colleagues, one of the tenor of comments that I got back was that the language that I was using was, and one of them actually said this, was hyperbolic. Well, it's true that if you actually look at my paper, the sort of words that are in there are not words that you typically find in an academic economics article. I refer to slavery as vile. I refer to it as a depravity. I refer to it as a barbarity. But the question is, are these words hyperbolic or are they accurate? And I suggest you know these words are not hyperbolic, they are accurate. They're accurate in the same way that we require accuracy out of our mathematical techniques. But economics has adopted this language, which is so neutered that it, when it confronts a phenomenon like slavery, it is almost dumb. We don't have appropriate standard words to talk about this economic phenomenon. Now, in the natural sciences, when they, so think of physics, when they encounter or have encountered in the past some new physical phenomenon of which they were hitherto unaware, they literally reinvented the language in order to talk about this new phenomenon that they were confronting. And we don't think that there's anything odd about that. We think that's actually what should happen. Well, certainly in the context of slavery, where we are so resistant to changing this terminology, the sort of language that we use, we are making a very serious intellectual error. Okay, because the words like vile and so on are not hyperbolic, they are not value-laden, they are accurate. And having thought about that, it explained to me a phenomenon that I've long puzzled about, which is when I meet these very, very top-tier economists in the top universities of the world you've ever come across, I am astonished at how often I think of them as clueless. They really have no idea what is going on in the world. And I think part of the reason why they don't is because they live in the world of economics, which has this completely neutered language. And if that's all you ever read, if that's all you ever come across, it's really not surprising if you end up kind of not having a particularly clear view about how the world actually works. But the reason why economics has adopted this incredibly neutered language is because it thinks of its primary job as being to be above the fray. We want to have value-neutral terms because we are a value-neutral discipline, and indeed that's where our authority comes from. And the implication is, therefore, that if we start using these value-neutral or hyperbolic words, that we are going to somehow step down off of our pedestal and lose our authority. Not so. The price of doing this is the loss of accuracy. So just as we require, we are using mathematics to improve our accuracy, I think we need to completely rethink our use of language on a similar basis. That's the second implication I have from slavery to the about what it implies about the character of economics, and why we go wrong. The third point I want to make is about theory, because I've described to you very briefly now this empirical phenomenon, which is gigantic, at the center of which is this denial of economic agency. So as an empirical question, we clearly have made some pretty dire blunders in the definition of our discipline. What about in theory? Well, as I've described, the business model was the deprivation of economic agency. If you want to see how it handles in theory, go to Aro de Breux. What does Aro de Breux have to say about economic agency? Well, what Aro de Breux does is it assumes, without actually saying so, universal economic agency. Everybody in Aro de Breux is an economic agent, and we study mathematically what they all do. Very interesting conclusions. But here's my observation. The problem with that is it overlooks the fact that people, and note my change of term, people in Aro de Breux, no individual people has an incentive, a private incentive, to ensure, to pay costs to ensure that the definition of economic agency is appropriate or that it's universal. And indeed, if little groups can form within, groups of people can form within Aro de Breux to impose an inappropriate definition, well, they get rewarded by houses. There are enormous returns within Aro de Breux to compromising the economic agency of others. This is a feature of Aro de Breux itself, right at the core of our discipline. Okay? And yet it's not anywhere in any of our textbooks or anything. This is probably the first time any of you have actually thought about this. So now you ask yourself, well, okay, what do you have to do as a modeling strategy in Aro de Breux in order to recover universal economic agency, given that there is this private incentive that people in it have it to compromise? Now you might think, well, okay, I know what to do in Area de Bruyne as a modeling strategy to recover universal economic agency. I can impose an assumption that the ability of individuals in Area de Bruyne to defend their own economic agency is homogenous. If everybody has the same ability to defend their own economic agency within Area de Bruyne, maybe that gets us back to universal economic agency. Well, before I answer whether it does or does not, I want to point out something about this particular modeling strategy itself. And that is that it is completely inconsistent with the rest of the Area de Bruyne model. The rest of the Area de Bruyne model assumes heterogeneous people. And here I am imposing on one dimension a homogeneity.
5 minutes.
Right. That is a very unsatisfactory modeling technique. And it's exactly the kind of modeling muddle which those of a neoclassical disposition as economists tend to accuse heterodox economists of doing. They say, we've got this nice clean model, and here you come, you impose some arbitrary outside assumption upon it, you yield all sorts of perverse conclusions and want to change government policy forever on this basis. No coherent logical basis, they say, of the heterodox. I'm saying that the neoclassical economists are guilty of exactly that. In the context of the way in which they treat Area de Bruyne, and in the context of what's necessary within Area de Bruyne to recover universal economic agency. But it's actually worse than that, because actually imposing homogeneity is not sufficient in Area de Bruyne to get you back to stable universal economic agency. Why not? Because I can come to Area de Bruyne and distribute some kind of characteristic randomly. Think skin pigmentation. Some people have this skin pigmentation, some people have that skin pigmentation. It's something which has got nothing to do with their productivity or with their preferences or whatever. It's just the color of your skin. If I distribute that unequally, then a majority can form to impose inappropriate economic agency on the minority. So in order within Area de Bruyne to get back to stable universal economic agency, you have to not only have some notion of homogeneity in individuals' ability to defend their economic agency, but you also need to have some kind of group homogeneity in order to render it stable. Now, this is a seriously heterodox set of modeling practices in order to recover something that they regarded as fundamental in their model. In other words, what I'm arguing is that neoclassical economics has made an absolutely fundamental logical failure at its core in assuming universal economic agency, just as in an empirical sense, we totally ignored the blindingly obvious evidence from many centuries at a huge scale that you cannot assume universal economic agency. And since I'm talking to a group of female presenters as colleagues, the same phenomenon applies to gender. Because you can deny or compromise economic agency across things more than just skin pigmentation. You can do it by gender too. And just as compromising it by skin pigmentation leads to enormous resource transfers to the people who are compromising the agency that way, to the slave owners, similarly for gender. If an average woman in the world is paid only 7/8 of her marginal product, well, over her lifetime, that's 1/8 of a house of which she is deprived. And you then multiply that up by the total number of women in the world, and you get a sense of the scale of this activity, which compromises the economic agency of women. It is gigantic. So my last point I want to make, since time is running short, is that if you follow this through, a typical kind of way that heterodox economists argue, and we've heard some of the flavors today, argue against those of a classical disposition. They say, we want you to be more inclusive. We want to be nicer. We want you to think about, poorer people, or people left out, put those more in the center of analysis. From the point of view that I'm arguing, the criticism needs to be much more fundamental. The criticism of the approach should not be we're asking mainstream to be nicer or more inclusive. We're asking them to stop making mistakes, to stop actually getting it wrong, So by analogy, think of Galileo. When Galileo came along and he said, sorry guys, it's actually the sun that's the center of our solar system. He wasn't asking mainstream astronomy to be more inclusive or nicer or kinder. He was saying to them, stop being incompetent. Now, of course, they didn't listen. They threw him into jail. They weren't very nice about it at all. And it took a subsequent generation for it actually to happen. But that's what needs to happen, in my view, with regard to economic agency. We need to stop being wrong about it. And to make it very clear how fundamental I think this is, and then I will stop. I took this argument to the people who are behind this core econ project, you know, this new project to write economics undergraduates texts around the world. It's a very good project. I like it. It's very much focused on power. They took umbrage at the fact that I was critical of their book too. And they said, no, we have actually got a piece about slavery. We have a box on slavery in our book. Go and look at it. So I did. This box has a box on a slave because they want to be gender conscious. The slave happens to be female in this example. But the box is discussing what this female slave does with their economic agency in the context of the fact she's actually a slave. Think of the mindset to think that this is a sensible thing to do. The way to deal with
could
economic
agency,
last sentence, yes, last okay. sentence, is just as in macroeconomics, when most macro, you start out looking at closed economy and shift to open economy macro. This analysis of economic agency says micro textbooks need to be written. You start off with a section which assumes universal economic agency, and then you shift to a whole discussion which nowhere exists anywhere now, which is of what happens when agency is not universal.
Perfect. Thank you so much for a great presentation. There is one of the things that I keep that keeps coming back to me is if we only earned 7/8 of men's wages, that would actually be a huge win. But absolutely. We have got some great questions during the different presentations. And I will ask two questions to each presenter and give you guys some time to answer these. And if we have more time in the end, we can take more questions as they come along. But starting now, I have a couple of questions for Christina. So can you guys see the questions as well?
Yes.
So one question is about Prebisch theory, which is usually presented as being the first major initiative in economics that did not start from a Eurocentric perspective by focusing on the big international differences in wealth and opportunity between industrial and non-industrial countries and what to do about them. Was that not a major step forward in itself, even if it did not refer to other areas of inequality? And also, have there been another school of economics since Prebisch inspired the structuralism that started from the point of view of the majority world? So if we could answer that question, also a question from Ingrid, this one was from Tom, thank you. If you could elaborate a bit on how a feminist perspective can help avoid Eurocentrism and this sort of structural issue that we are experiencing in economics, and how we can assure that a feminist perspective on core periphery relationship is sensitive to class and race relations as well. Thank you. Then I have two questions for Serbi. From Tom, thanking you for a great presentation, but the question is, casual forms of labor have existed throughout the history of capitalism, while in new forms such as quasi-informality have emerged under neoliberalism. Things such as zero-hour contracts or fictitious self-employment in companies such as Uber. Was it wrong to actually assume or move informal labor to the developing world alone? And another question, can your data on churning distinguish exits to unemployment or exits from the labor market, such as retirement? Or is that something that might be falling under transitions? Let's see. Peter, you're going to have the least questions because you're the last presenters and it's going to come during the time. One of the main comments, I think, is what would you recommend that we are going to do to take a step forward? So if we have these four main issues, what could be a starting point? You've been focusing on the Arrow de Brault model. Do you have any in your paper suggesting what is the transformation that you would like to see? We're starting with Christina, take Serbi, and then Peter, please.
Well, so first of all, I would like to thank my webinar mates, let's say Peter and Serbi, for the very interesting presentations. I learned a lot here, and I was thinking about what you were saying. And well, secondly, Tom, I hope you still can hear me. I'm very glad to have your question. I remember that 2 years ago in Leicester, you were at my presentation too. And you made also a great contribution. You made me questions, and I think we were exchanging some emails later. So for sure, okay. I do not mean that the Plebiscite manifesto is not important. Of course it is, it's a milestone. And it opened up a huge stream of thoughts in Latin America that is still nowadays is very influencing, right? So, and then it was, well, we were saying, well, this manifesto is usually taken as non-Eurocentric. And I was saying that it is. So I think that my answer for this is that it is and it's not. It's non-Eurocentric, especially when it fights the comparative advantages theory, and it claims for a theory from Latin America to understand our own problems. At this perspective, it's non-Eurocentric. But in my view, it is Eurocentric when it is talking about development from another point of view of development, which is not ours, it's not popular. There is no discussion on what is development. It is taking development for granted as something that we want to reach and to become industrialized, like the industrialized countries from Europe and the USA, let's say. Okay, so it is and it is not. And we are criticizing in our paper, more precisely, this way of defining of or taking development and not the contribution from the region and taking, looking for answers from the region, okay? So yes, it was a big step, okay? And then you ask, has there been any other school of economics inspired structuralism? Yes, there are some. Also in the dependent theory, as Ingrid was also asking about, so there are some authors that we can highlight. I personally like Florestan Fernandes, for example, from Brazil, who was bringing especially the racism issue to his analysis, and he was in the end proposing the complete rupture with the capitalism and system, the central periphery system, and the associate dependency scheme, right? And then we have Milton Santos, we have Vania Bambira, who was bringing the feminism into the analysis, and not only in Latin America, for example, if we look into the African region, we can see the Pan-Africanists, we have Samir Amin, we have Frantz Fanon, we have great African thinkers that were also analyzing the center-periphery schemes and looking to new definitions for development, especially, more than maybe some of the structuralists in the 40s and the 50s. I don't know well the Indian and the Asian literature, but I'm sure that there are many examples from there too. And then next question from Ingrid. Well, this is a project for the entire life. Now, how can I elaborate more on how feminist perspective can better avoid the Eurocentrism? But this actually is the main topic of the paper. And I think that the answer is on in the nature of the Latin America feminism, because it was born as a political agenda associated to race and ethnical racial issues and class issues. It was never apart. The nature of the Latin America feminism is first born during the second wave of feminism was during the military dictatorship. So it was a kind of time, authoritarian times with lots of repression, and then the feminist movement was fighting against this authoritarian state and in defense of any kinds of oppressions, not only against women. So the nature of this feminism was already worried with other categories, and it was conjugated with the racial issues especially, okay? And it was also it was also fighting against any imposed views of development. So this was also not Eurocentric by nature, right? So that's how I think, and also not economicist. It was actually a political and cultural institutional view of the society, and also economy. It was interdisciplinary by nature. I think I could explain this. And there is one thing more: how to ensure that a feminist perspective on core periphery relations is sensitive. Oh, so that's what I was saying. So the nature of the Latin American feminism is like this. So
perfect.
This is the way we answer that.
Thank you so much, Christina.
Can I just add one thing? Good. In the questions from Tom to Surbi? because it's very similar. There are many critiques on the dualist view of the interpretation of economics, saying that actually in capitalism can convive, can live with other ways of relation, not paid relations.
I'm sorry, I'm gonna interrupt here. We have 7 minutes until we need to wrap up. So I am gonna be, I'm sorry. Thank you so much.
It's really not capitalist. Cannot survive with slavery. So it's all part of one same thing.
No, thank you so much. I just want to remind everyone that we have a discussion forum, so you can go to our website and find discussion forums and keep these discussions going after, because we're so limited by time. Normally we can have a coffee and keep going after, so you want to use these discussion forums for that kind of questions. Serbi, do you please want to give answer to your questions?
Thanks. Thanks a lot. And thanks, Christina and Peter. They were very fascinating presentations as well. And Peter, if you could also just send in the link to the paper, I would really love to read it. And thanks a lot. I'll first take Peter's question, which is about that. Does it also include transitions to, let's say, unemployment or out of labor force? No, I'm mainly looking at employment transitions because I want to kind of have my analysis mainly focused on these employment relations and production and employment structures. But that is something that I, along with another of my co-authors, kind of working on, because in India there's this massive movement of women out of labor force, and that's like a huge phenomenon, and that's something that we are kind of, which is also a reporting problem, because if men don't have job, they say they're unemployed. If women don't have job, they say they're taking care of the household. So that's one, but that's something that we're looking into as another thing. Tom, very interesting question. Thanks a lot for that. First, and I'll relate it briefly to Christina's question as well. So in this sort of understanding that, yes, were there other sort of relations that existed? You know, now there's this guy standing, has this understanding where he comes and says that, you know, the new precariat, the new working class, we're all precariat now, sort of a thing, right? Like all informal labor relations. But there's a basic distinction between it. One, in terms of that the new forms of labor relations, let's say Uberization and gig economy, that's emerging now. I know you've asked about the historical thing, which I'll touch upon, but which are emerging now are basically something that has happened after they've undergone a capitalist transition. Whereas what exists in the global South economies mainly is when they've not undergone the capitalist transition. So what we're seeing is that you undergo the capitalist transition and then there again this rising of these non-capitalist spaces. So it, in that way, it's questioning capitalist transition. In global South, it is saying that, okay, look, we've not undergone that transition and still there are these, and they've continued to persist and reproduce. So there are two different ways of questioning it. But I agree with you that historically, yes, that existed, but the entire Fordist regime, which was the post-World War capitalism, was the promise of capitalism under which the entire development literature is kind of based. That was the capitalist transition that kind of forms the basis of it. And Christine, I completely agree with you that there are multiple forms of capitalism. That's why I'm making a distinction between capitalism and capitalist spaces. So what Sanal and others would actually argue is saying that what you see in India is not that we are lagging behind in a capitalist transition, which is majorly the dominant form of Marxism, Marxist understandings that exist even now to understand the development literature, where the argument is that, look, there's going to be this capitalist transition. But Sanal and others' argument would be that this is capitalist transition. In India, the post-colonial nature of capitalism is such that you had this constant reproduction of non-capitalist, which was earlier seen as this underdevelopment, quote-unquote underdevelopment, which you linked in terms of the Eurocentric vision of development itself. That was exactly the basic problem under which this entire development literature is kind of premised. So thank you. And thanks for the questions and presentations.
Thank you so much. That was, I feel like I would love to have time for so many more questions. Finally, Peter, do you want to answer your question?
Yes, very briefly. But Serbia, I think you'll find my paper either on the Heterodox Economics website for this conference, or if you don't find it, you can also find it in the National Institute of Economic and Social Research website out of London. It's a blog there. So the question you asked was another very sweeping one. I'm going to give 2 minutes worth of answer to a gigantic question, which is, what do I want to have happen as a result of this thinking? Well, two things. One is about the way in which economics is taught, and the second is about policy in the world. I've already said about, I think the issue is so fundamental. We have got our core economic concept wrong. We have built a whole profession on the assumption that everybody is an economic agent in the face of obvious evidence that they're not. And because we've got something so fundamental, so wrong, I can assure you that if you read the paper, you'll see it has tentacles reaching out all over the place in the discipline. So I'll just leave it, there needs to be those changes. In regard to the form of changes of what we teach, I've already summarized it. I think that just as in macroeconomics, you have teach people closed economy and then you switch to open economy. I think we need to completely rewrite our micro textbooks, and this is micro theory, to start off with what happens in theory if you have universal agency, and then have a whole new section. It would be half the book, which says, and now what happens if you do not have universal economic agency? And to anybody who says, well, this is ridiculous, why we have to do this, slavery is outlawed, why are we worrying about all of this? Two things I'll say. If you go and look at our classicals, here's a book of these people, 20 of their writings described. In this book, you look at entries under slavery, there are 3. We weren't writing about slavery even when it was legal. And I can assure you that in many parts of the world, it is not a crime. In fact, in half the countries of the world today, it is not a crime to own a slave. So absolutely it is current. And absolutely through gender and other things, it reaches into other issues. We need to rewrite microeconomic theory textbooks around this problem. Policy. The big policy that needs to change, and I will not summarize it because it's the whole third section of my paper, is reparations for African Americans. I establish an argument there that we don't make reparations for African Americans, so we want to be nice, or we want to have atonement, or we want to deal with Black Lives Matter problems, it's laid out as an economic argument is necessary to secure universal reparations, is the argument, are necessary to secure universal economic agency now. That's a very big policy. If you want to see it all detailed, it's all in the paper.
Thank you so much. Let's do it. let's rewrite this book. So let's change. Let's create the change that we need. Some amazing presentations. Thank you so much to all of you. Please continue these discussions on our discussion board. There is a presentation now after another AAG session. I am going to look over my shoulder to see where it is. And I scrolled away. It's a panel number that the panel that starts at 5 o'clock. It's on anti-colonial and post-colonial development. And we have 3 speakers. So if you're interested, please have a break, have a cup of tea, and join us again at 5 o'clock. Once again, thank you so much, Christina, Serbi, and Peter. That was great presentations. I hope that we can see each other face to face at the conference at some point and have that sort of chat afterwards with a cup of tea or a coffee. Thank you, everyone who joined.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Thanks.
Thank you very much.
Bye.
Thanks.
Ciao.
I will now cloud recording.